हेलो, आई थिंक वी कैन स्टार्ट. ओके ओके ऑलराइट. हाय, वेलकम बालाजी. सो वेलकम एवरीबडी टू आवर फेसबुक लाइव सीरीज वेर इन वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट टीचर कॉम्पिटेंसीज. सो वी आर डूइंग टू टाइप्स ऑफ फेसबुक लाइव सीरीज वेर इन वन वी टॉक अबाउट वट आर द कॉम्पिटेंसीज दैट आर नीडेड टू बी अ गुड टीचर. एंड द सेकेंड कैटेगरी ऑफ फेसबुक लाइव सेशंस दैट वी डू आर विद टीचर्स हु बिल्ट ग्रेट करियर्स एज टीचर्स एंड हु कैन बी इंस्पायरिंग टू वेरियस टीचिंग प्रोफेशनल्स अराउंड अस. एंड इन टूडेज सीरीज ऑफ बिल्डिंग टीचर कॉम्पिटेंसीज आई एम वेरी प्लीज टू हैव बालाजी विद अस लाइव हियर फ्रॉम चेन्नई. बालाजी इज अ वेरी हैज हैड अ फैंटास्टिक career as a teacher. He did his education from IIT Chennai, and after that he's done his PhD from University of Maryland, and after that he chose to be an educationist. So let's start today's session first of all by asking him what made him decide to become a teacher and how did this journey start for him.
I wanted to explain things to children. And I when I was a, I had a few teachers in my when I was in school, who were very different and who really inspired me. So, the teachers I found who were really good or people from whom I learned a lot were teachers who, for example, there was a teacher called Lucina George and a bunch of teachers in school. And usually, when I would ask a question, they would try to understand it from my point of view. But there are lots of teachers who would just simply repeat what they just said. I didn't understand it the first time, so I do think if they repeat it 2 times, I'll understand. So I felt like teachers who are trying to look at it from my perspective were the ones who really helped me learn more. So I felt like that's something that I wanted to do. So generally, I wanted to get into education, mainly to at least look at explaining things a little better, understanding from children's point of view what they are finding difficulty with. What are they saying? Because half the time when they ask a doubt, we give the answer that we often think is the correct answer, but we don't know what they are actually thinking, how are they approaching the problem. And sometimes it's very interesting to learn that because it also allows us to learn. So for me, teaching has always been a mixture of learning for me, because when they look at it in a new way, that helps me understand the same topic in a completely different new light. So that was what my main motivation to get into teaching was.
Brilliant. So I think that brings us to the main theme of the session, and which seems to have pretty much inspired your teaching journey as to how we can make topics easy for children in the classroom. And I would say not just easy, but sort of spark thought process in them, think of it of in terms of problem solving in the broader context, instill critical learning skills, and also make the entire process enjoyable for them. So if you can share some live example with us in terms of how you teach this to children and how it can be helpful for our teacher audience, that would be really useful.
See, I think what the 3 points you mentioned are all of these are very critical in the sense that what I find is if a child gets inspired or excited about learning a topic more, you find that they are willing to go to great lengths. Like, is, for example, physics boring? Well, that depends on how you teach it. Or, for example, what kind of curiosity do you bring there? Like, let's take Newton's laws. You can make a statement of 3 Newton's laws. If they have to remember it and they have to state it the right way and they have to write it down and they have to kind of vomit it back in the exam, that is not very exciting. When you talk about Newton's third law, for example, which is something that everybody would be able to mouth, looking at examples, an example of Newton's third law, that makes it something very far away. It's not something related to day-to-day stuff. If you're walking, you're talking about Newton's third law. If I move my hand, then I'm okay. So usually what we try to do is to do experiments in class with materials that able to do it when they actually are in a setting. Like, for example, they go to a straw. So my question typically is, if I had a straw like this, and this straw, I blow air, the air is going to come out that way, right? if I bend the straw and I connect, which is what I've done here. So I have a straw like this, mm-hmm. bent, and then the second part of the straw I've bent this way. So basically it's nothing but two different straws, mm-hmm. one just simply pushed into the other,
okay.
that way.
Okay.
So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to blow into this. Mm-hmm. So when I blow air into this, the air is going to come out of that. So when the air comes out of that, Newton's third law, the meaning of it, is that when the straw pushes the air that way, the air pushes the straw this way. So which means the straw should start to rotate. Mm-hmm. And when you get kids to do this, the point that they can do a little bit of science, apply Newton's third law whenever you're with a drinking straw, suddenly makes them much more excited.
Okay.
Like, experiments is one very important part of getting kids to really understand, at least with science, that's a definite thing. Even in social science, I would think that getting kids to kind of convert, don't think of it as dates and facts, but mm-hmm. rather think in terms of what would you do in a situation like this. So that means they are actually thinking about it, analyzing it. Mm-hmm. So where you can build curiosity, I think excitement to know a lot more starts coming in. Mm-hmm. Automatically, once curiosity comes in, I think the next step is like you're saying, when I start applying it to problems, it's not obviously easy. Mm-hmm. So at that stage, I think making it easy would be a great step. So
okay.
Usually what I do there is to find out why is it difficult.
Okay.
As an example, I spent a lot of time with kids trying to look at work energy questions mm-hmm. that they face in the 11th and 12th grade, mm-hmm. Particularly for when they were preparing for IITs as well as for the schools.
Okay.
And they would know the equation.
Okay.
They would know what to do. They know the formula for kinetic energy. They know the formula for energy. They know all of that. They even know how to write it down for a simple case. But when the problem gets a little bit more complex, let's say the ball rolls down, something comes down and moves it to some place, it hits a spring, compresses. By the time they write it, they've got thoroughly confused because there is a before, there is an after. Mm-hmm. There is before kinetic energy, there is an after kinetic energy, there is before kinetic energy. And which one to add, which one to subtract was a big mess. So after spending some time with kids trying to find out what they were doing,
mm-hmm.
what I realized was if I can provide some sort of a systematic way for them to write,
okay.
simplified matters. After a little bit of working out, I came up with a table idea.
Okay.
So we started saying, let's draw an energy table.
Mm-hmm.
So just don't worry about writing an equation on the board. I would do that, and then they would do that in their notebooks. So they would just simply draw a table before, after, different forms of energy,
okay.
and put the numbers in.
Okay.
Then it just simply became a matter of total energy in the beginning is total energy in the end. So the sudden problem solving simplification it did.
Okay.
Earlier, if more than half the class had difficulty writing the equation correctly, now almost all of them were able to do it. And that basically meant every question that I would give them, now they were getting it right.
Okay.
With huge confidence. Now they want to do more of work energy question. In fact, they wouldn't want to go to the next topic.
Okay.
So that kind of a thing starts happening.
But from so one which I've taken from this is that doing a lot of experiments and relating it to everyday objects, relating it to everyday activities around us
Definitely.
Is a great way to teach Definitely. Children, irrespective of what the subject is, be it science, social studies, language, whatever it is.
And you can do this in two ways. One is you can take a topic,
mm-hmm.
and when you're introducing Newton's laws,
mm-hmm.
you can discuss what can I do with a straw.
Uh-huh.
I can demonstrate Newton's laws with using a straw, different kinds of materials around us.
Mm-hmm.
But you could also ask other questions. Like, for example, if now you have a straw,
mm-hmm.
think about 10 different things that you could do with the straw,
mm-hmm.
which involves different kinds of science principles.
Mm-hmm.
As an example, I would say, if I took this straw and tried to stick it to this board,
mm-hmm.
it is not actually sticking there.
Mm-hmm.
But what would happen if I charge this straw? So okay. people would learn about charges.
Mm-hmm.
But if I take a piece of paper
mm-hmm.
and I try to charge, and it's very easy to charge things up.
Mm-hmm.
You just have to kind of rub it, hold it tight and pull this.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't need complicated equipment or experiments because those kind of give you the sense that you can only do science or learn it if you had big, big materials, not things around you.
Mm-hmm.
A straw and a paper is something every child can have access to. Now I'm claiming I have charged this, and if I now try to stick it to the board, it sticks. In fact, we can see how long it sticks, right? So it'll stick there until I pull it out or something else happens.
Okay.
But the basic, once they start seeing, they'll say, no, I don't believe, let me come and stick it.
Mm-hmm.
If a child, you manage to get a child to say, I want to try this out.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, let me try and show you.
Mm-hmm.
I will demonstrate that the teacher is wrong. you have already got the child curious. Mm-hmm. Now the child is going to spend enormous amount of time, far more than you would expect. That child can spend that kind of time to actually learn that subject. So I feel part of the learning game is to get children really excited about spending time to learn.
Okay.
And they will be able to, if they're interested, they will find the time. I mean, okay. Because they're constantly thinking about it. They will go and say, let me try this thing and see whether it works. So I feel that experiment that way is definitely a key component.
Okay.
And it can be done in two ways. It can be done as, I have this material. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. What all can you do with a piece of paper? What all can you do with a piece of straw?
Okay.
So that's, there you're getting them to creatively think through ideas.
Right, right.
The second is to use it as a demonstration thing as to illustrate a concept.
Right.
I think both go hand in hand. One starts happening first and then the second one slowly kids start to pick up.
Okay.
The making the subject easy, I think, is something that requires us to think about what are their real difficulties.
Mm-hmm,
you
mm-hmm.
walk around in the class, talk to each student, look, and they should start feeling comfortable enough to tell you, I'm not getting this. This is hard.
Okay.
So I think once that starts happening, I feel big change starts happening both in terms of the classroom interaction as well as from the teacher's side and the student's side. I feel like when I started teaching, I learned the subject a lot more.
When?
Because the kids would ask me all sorts of things and I'll say, actually, I don't understand it well.
Okay.
Because I can't explain it to you well now because I don't understand it.
Right. Right.
So each year what I did, because again, you have to teach the whole syllabus and there's just too much stuff to learn.
Right.
So I would pick one topic and spend huge amount of time on that one topic.
Okay.
And do one class and then try out another class. Because to develop experiments, to you can't do that for the whole year. But I'm going to teach for many years. So therefore, the plan was each year I would take one topic and try and become a little better at that topic.
Yeah.
And so even today, I have certain topics that I'm not very comfortable with.
Uh-huh,
uh-huh. Like she knows many of the topics that I'm not very good at.
Okay.
The topics that I'm good at, I'm able to do it very comfortably.
Right.
So.
Right.
But all the years that I spent in graduate school and college, clearly I didn't learn very much. So I learned it when with the children when they were actually asking me questions.
Okay.
That's the real time you can learn. But you can do that over a period of time. We have many years to learn. So
what you are saying is there is no shortcut to learning, even as a teacher. And in fact, the process of being a teacher is also about a process of continuous learning, which we of course hear from our great teachers all the time, so it comes as no surprise. And I think what Balaji is talking about is how he's in a way demonstrating it in his daily life. So Balaji, one question I had based on what you just described, that one of course is using a lot of experiments and doing a lot of activities to make it fun for the children and to make the concept sort of stick into children's minds. But from a teacher's point of view, when, for example, you start teaching about Newton's laws or when you start teaching about charges or circuits or whatever be the topic, how do you as a teacher figure out that this is the sequence in which I should be teaching Newton's laws or certain topics, or this is the sequence, or these are the linkages between, let's say, Newton's law and charging, etc. So how as the teacher do you take care of some of these aspects of teaching in the classroom?
I mean, one is a practical question, one is what is possible. Earlier when I used to work with the school system and I was doing a lot more work within school teachers, even teachers, there are lots of constraints that syllabus and curriculum imposes. So you can only stick within that.
Okay.
Nowadays, as somebody who does it outside, so I conduct tuition classes, right? So I go at one, I decide, okay, I'm going to start with this topic or that topic. And it keeps evolving. Almost every year, I kind of try to shuffle.
Mm-hmm.
I try to say, okay, this is what I don't think I did a great job last year. So this year, I'm going to try a new technique. So for example, most books, let's say 12th standard, at least in physics, because that's what I'm most familiar with. So 12th standard physics starts with electrostatics, which is one of the harder topics.
Okay.
Then much later, they start with current electricity.
Okay.
And again, by the time the kids come to current electricity, they've given up, half of the kids have given up. So what I realized was if I can just reverse the whole thing, and logical framework was that you need... For current electricity, the reason somebody has come up with this as the structure is because you need forces, electric forces. Coulomb's law will tell you a little bit about potential. And then from potential, you need to get there to current.
Mm-hmm.
So because you'll need for Ohm's law and all that, you'll need potential drop and so on. But that is a logical framework, right?
Okay.
But you're not going to get kids to learn necessarily in the logical, historical framework, the way it evolved. All of that is not really necessary. If you look at what is the easiest for children, I came up with a simple solution saying, okay, I'm going to tell you two laws.
Okay.
The first law, we will come back to this law later when we get to electrostatics, but first law is that every point in the universe, every point here, there, every single place has a number. We can't see this number, but this number has a name. We call it potential, electric potential.
Okay.
So if this point has a potential, that point has a potential. When I go from here to there, let's say this was 7 and that was 3, I have a potential drop of 7 to 3, which is basically 4 volts.
Okay.
We use units of volts. Okay. I have not explained what potential is. I have not explained what volts is.
Okay.
But once they get a, I said, don't have to know anything more than the fact that every point has a number.
Okay.
And then let's get started.
Okay.
Because if this point has a number, and that point has a number, and this was 7, that was, let us say, 3. I went like that. I had a drop of 4 volts.
Okay. Okay.
And let us say I went from here to here. And then I go this way. I have a drop of 7 to 2. So that means I have a drop of 5.
Right.
And if I go from 2 to 3, I don't have a drop of 1. I have a drop of minus 1.
Right.
So if I did this, then I had a drop of 5 and a drop of 1. So I had a drop of 4. And I went that way. I had a drop of 4. So that means, and we can show this with 2-3 different examples. You start here and you end there. Whether you go that way or you go this way, you have the same drop.
Okay.
Now, they've not really got where did this potential come from, how was it created, not any of that. But then from this straight away, you can actually get down to looking at electric circuit problems. Within a class, they're able to solve some really difficult looking questions.
Okay.
That would have scared them. Now, they can solve it almost mentally. By the end of the class, they feel like so confident. Now, I really love electric circuits. This I'm super confident about. Now, what happens is, by the time they get to a harder topic, this confidence stays.
Okay.
So, I know a lot of this. That one topic is a little hard. Okay, I'll put some extra effort.
Okay.
If the first topic starts being hard, so for example, one of the things at least I have generally done, I feel like very strongly about, is if we can restructure the topic such that you go from easy to hard, most of the time you felt confident that you knew this, you knew that, you knew. One thing you don't know, it's okay. You start with, I don't know. It's very hard to get that confidence back because you always are reminded about the fact that you don't know that topic. So I have always tried to see if I can restructure.
Okay.
In schools, it may be a little hard. You have to get permission from many different sources.
Okay.
I mean, you do have to complete the portion, of course.
Yeah.
But if you can redo it in a way in which it start with the easy first and then move on to the hard. Like, for example, I don't teach friction in the beginning.
Okay.
But I teach complicated looking questions with Newton's laws. And then after a little while, once they feel comfortable, then when I introduce friction, it is just one more thing to get added on. So I feel that we can, there's a lot of restructuring that needs to be done within our syllabus.
Okay.
Because people who wrote the books wrote it keeping historical growth. They wrote it assuming that this is how logically it must be done. Because from here you derive that and from there you derive. Like how do you come up with potential? But that is not what a child is right now interested in.
Right.
You don't have to talk about algebra and the meaning of multiplication before you introduce multiplication, simple multiplication to children.
Okay.
So we have to understand pedagogy is different from the historical or the logical framework of a subject. So I think that is something that we need to, each teacher has to evolve with time.
Okay. So what Balaji is saying, and if I understand correctly, based on your experience, that we don't need to really stick to predefined frameworks in terms of linkages. And as you practice teaching, more and more you realize what makes the child more confident, develop the confidence, and thereby look at the restructuring of the content that you are teaching to the child. So I'll just like to highlight over here that as part of CENTA standards, so we have 5 categories of micro-credentials or certifications that we test for, and the content planning and development is one of them. And within that, this is one of the main things that we test for. And we test for it in a very practical manner, in a very experiential manner, taking into account broad-based teaching practices, exactly the kind of things that you're talking about. And in the corresponding TPO sections, for example, we will exactly look for things like what should be the what's the best way to introduce a specific concept to a child in the classroom, for example. So, which brings me to the next question that all the teachers in India are teaching in different contexts, be it the socioeconomic context of the classroom, be it the diversity of children in the classroom in terms of where they are in their learning path, etc. So some of the methods that you described here, for example, if I were to look at the way you spoke about teaching equations from the kinetic energy perspective using the table, if you had to use some other pedagogical method based on where a student is in his or her learning path, what could be the other ways of teaching the same concept?
I think that's a very, very important point. I mean, because it depends ultimately the way I just quickly get a little bit of a background. I was involved with, I started a nonprofit called Aid India, and we were working with almost close to like 13,000 teachers. Government school teachers private school teachers also, quite a lot.
Okay.
And we still do that work now with quite a few schools going on.
Okay.
We started with basic language learning, mathematics, and then English. And of course, a lot of science, because science was some area that I was spending a lot of time on. But both math and language was an area that I spent quite a bit of time.
Okay.
One of the things that I learned, when I started, I was like 24. So at that time, and almost close to about 15, 20 years, we worked with these schools, teachers and so on.
Mm-hmm.
In the beginning, I would say we made a lot of mistakes, particularly this idea of looking at what is the best way to introduce or teach a topic was something that was always in my head.
Mm-hmm.
Over a period of time, I realized there is no such thing.
I mean,
so in fact, we started our team, both at AHA Guru as well as at Aid India, one of the core beliefs that we have, and we've been focusing a lot on that, is that as a teacher, you should think of yourself like a mechanic.
Okay.
You go to look at so let's say I have to open up some nut or something.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't go there saying, I have this spanner, I will go and open that nut of that size. You go with a bag of tools. You have lots of spanners of different sizes. So you go there to look at that nut and say, okay, this nut requires that kind of a spanner, right?
Mm-hmm.
So I have a tool bag.
Okay.
I don't have to use every spanner on every nut first.
Mm-hmm.
I should have a big set of spanners.
Mm-hmm.
But which spanner I'm going to use with which nut depends on that particular situation.
Okay.
And whether even then, if it doesn't open, then so I first try with one. If it does not, is it not the right size, is too big or too small, then I look for the next one.
Mm-hmm.
So the way we see our own teacher training programs as well as what we do is we have a toolkit.
Okay.
It is not it is not something that you look at as this is the pedagogy, this is the methodology that teachers must use.
Mm.
It is rather the teachers have access to all of these possibilities.
Okay.
You look at the student and you decide, okay, with this student, I must try this. And if this approach does not work, and with every student, every approach won't work.
Right.
So then you say, okay, if this does not work, then what else do I do?
Right.
And the harder it gets, actually, it's more interesting, because you say, I tried this, I tried that, and it's still not working.
Hmm, hmm.
So what is this guy thinking? Why is she or he not able to get it? What is going on in the child? See, the way I say this is, there are two ways in which you can teach.
Okay.
You can say, I'm going to say whatever I know.
Hmm.
So from my head to my mouth.
Okay.
As a student, you got to hear it and you have to understand. Now, is it harder to go from my head to my mouth?
Hmm.
Or is it harder to go from my ear to my brain? Which is to understand, like, which is the harder job here?
Okay.
So I would say, if as a teacher, I am saying what I already know, and the student has to understand what I know, the student is doing the harder job.
Okay.
And the student is struggling with it.
Right.
You can't blame the student.
Yeah.
My point there is then, you do the harder job. You ask the student to say, okay, now in your head, there is something going on. You tell me, what are you thinking?
Yeah.
Let me try to understand. Now, you can't do that with the whole class. You can do it at a particular point. You say, I've tried the first tool, I've got the second, it's not working. So this child has something else going on. So you explain to me, take some more time. But it's great learning for us, because now you're saying, okay, this child thought of it that way.
Okay.
Why is this child? And if the child is thinking, you get to know, because there are children trying to understand, struggling with it, trying to think, and they're not getting it.
Okay.
They're not getting it the way you want them to, but they've got something else. So then but for you to understand what the child has thought is an interesting puzzle.
Yes.
As an interesting puzzle, and if you are interested in it, there's a lot to learn there in that whole exercise. So I feel that many times, then that, so what it usually does is with one round like that, then I remember that and say, okay, this was a great question. For me, the interesting students are not the ones who understood it the first time. Okay. I learned nothing from them. So for me, the interesting students are the ones who didn't understand. Because then I can actually try and find out, what are you thinking? Oh, that's a new way of thinking, which I didn't know. It adds something new in my toolkit. Next time, I can use that in the class.
Is there any example which comes to your mind, a simple quick
example? No, this energy thing itself was one like that.
Okay.
But I'll tell you one very nice thing which actually helped me develop an entire module around this. Nowadays, I don't use the old method.
Okay.
Whenever there are, for example, moving pulleys has been a big area of difficulty for many children.
Okay.
So they would get, let me see if I can draw it here. They would get questions of this sort. And if this is just one pulley, it was easy.
Okay.
But sometimes they would get like maybe a second pulley going like that. And some block here and a block there. Now the problem is, if this fellow moves up, that is going to move down. But if this moves up by X, that doesn't move down by X.
Okay.
So the way to calculate it usually was, the way to usually calculate this would be that you write this length plus that length. You call it constraint equation. Then you differentiate it. By the time students do this, it's going to be one very long. Secondly, they really find this hard.
Okay.
So after spending quite a bit of time with different students, finding out what they had difficulty with,
okay,
I started thinking about how to make it obvious.
Okay.
So we said, okay, here is a pulley and there is a block.
Okay.
If I move my hand up by X, so this, let's say, goes up by 2 meters.
Okay.
Okay. That is going to go down by 2 meters.
Okay.
Now, can we think about this process as a step-by-step process?
Okay.
So I started saying, okay, let's freeze this. Assume that you're God for some time.
Okay.
And you move this thing up. Now there is a slack here.
Okay.
And then the slack moves from this side. So if you can just hold this ball for a second.
Okay.
So I'll just show you how this, we can assume that that was the pulley. And I move this up. There is a slack there.
Okay.
Now I'm going to move this slack from this side to that side. Since we have decided we are all gods right now, this ball doesn't go down, it basically stays there. So I call this freeze movement.
Okay.
Now there is a slack, so you're moving the slacks around. Now if I move this by X, that means the slack on that side, now because I pulled all the slack off to that side, now that slack is X. So that means to get rid of the slack, I need to move this down by X.
Okay.
So if this goes up by X, that comes down by X, which is a very easy and simple thing. But for a more complex question, you can do the same thing, because all you have to recognize is when the ball moves, there's only one rope hanging here, so therefore only one slack of X. But if the pulley moves down, both sides the rope comes down. So if the pulley moves down by half a meter, you'll have half a meter on this side and half a meter on that side. So 2 times half a meter, right? So you'll end up with 2X. So for example, if I say I lift this guy up, that means I'm going to end up with some slack here and a slack there.
Okay.
So this slack comes down. So similarly, when you move this pulley up, you'll find that you'll be able to get on both sides. If this pulley moves up, you'll get both sides slack. So that one little bit of idea, suddenly they don't need equations.
Okay.
Because they can do the entire thing in their mind. So at the end of the class, everybody wants to know, give me one more question and I can solve it mentally. Similarly, for example, calculus.
Yeah.
I found that when you're introducing calculus, unfortunately, the way our NCERT syllabus is designed, they say that they will learn differentiation at the end of 11th standard in mathematics.
Okay.
But they will assume you know it by the beginning of 11th standard in physics.
Okay.
So physics will have one class of differentiation.
Okay.
Whereas 11th and 12th standard, you actually have like one whole book of mathematics, half 6 months of calculus,
okay,
which we assume can be done in half a, like one day or 2 days of class in beginning of 11th standard.
Okay.
Which obviously means something is wrong. Somebody has not thought through the whole thing systematically. So how do you introduce whole of calculus to kids, at least when they get started?
Okay.
And they're also afraid of it in the beginning. So I said, okay, we'll sing it. You're afraid of writing calculus. Therefore, we will close the book and we will do the whole thing mentally.
I wish I had you as a teacher
so
when I was
sing
a
calculus.
Child. Okay.
So we would basically, like for example, instead of telling them that the calculus equation is differential or differentiation of uv is u dv plus v du, by which time they forget what they are doing.
Okay.
I would introduce this as, imagine I have a function 1 and a function 2. So the way to differentiate this is 1, 2, and get them to repeat it.
Okay.
Plus 2, 1.
Okay.
So it's very funny. First they laugh, then I say, no, you should do it like nursery rhyme. So they say, sing it. Like for example, if you have to differentiate 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So I tell them it is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
Okay.
Plus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what are you doing in that 4? You can't repeat the 4. Because the next question would be x sin x.
Okay.
So you can't tell me x sin x. You have to actually do that. Sin x time is to differentiate and give me the answer.
Okay.
And so that means once we learned a little bit of oral calculus, they come back and give me the answer. So they say x square sin x, for example, would be x square. The sin x differentiation is going to be cos x plus sin x, and differentiation of x square is 2x. And I start by saying, end of the class, we will try to not understand anything, but we will know any question any teacher throws at you, you will be able to solve.
Okay.
Then we will come back to learning and understanding, because it's once the confidence has got built up.
Like, right.
Otherwise, you're looking at dy dx, first time you're seeing it, you've not understood it, there's a whole bunch of formulas. It's scary. Half the learning problem is that a child is afraid. Once you're afraid, you stop learning. So you have got to feel like, no, I know this and I'm interested. I'm going to learn more. It's a journey. So can we make the journey pleasant and something that they feel is something they can enjoy?
Yeah.
And also never feel afraid of. They should work hard. There's no problem working hard, but not with fear. In fact, there are kids who now come to my classes from different places. They go to some places and they find that they're really tortured there. Heavy lot of questions. In the middle, they come. They're afraid to ask questions, because many times they say, if they ask a question, it may be a silly doubt. So I tell them, there is no silly doubt.
Okay.
If you are not asking a question, it's entered your head and you're not asked, you are being silly. The doubt is never silly. So ask any doubt that you feel like, because that is something that is how learning happens. I feel these parts where we try to look at it from the child's point perspective, keeps it also interesting for us. Otherwise, year after you're teaching the same thing. What is new?
Yeah.
As a teacher, what is new is that the child is new. The child is asking a new question. Something new, the way they thought about it, is our learning, I think, for us.
So, besides the physics masterclass that we are having today, what I'm also hearing as a constant theme in what Balaji is saying, and maybe that's a session for another day, is that if the concepts are strong, then solving questions or cracking tests actually becomes a very easy job. So whether it's the Teaching Professionals Olympiad, or whether that our teachers take, or whether it is the various competitive exams that our students take, it's all about getting that conceptual clarity, and really not about mugging for the tests per se. And the various pedagogical methods and resources that we can use in the classroom really help in making this easy, enjoyable, and a lifelong process. And so with that, I'll come to
I think the lifelong process is very important.
Absolutely.
Because to me, that they should score marks, they should get all of that. Like, for example, many of the kids who come to me come for IIT classes.
Right.
So they want to prepare for competitive exam. Some will get through, some won't get through. And the point is, whether you get through or not, they should feel like this is something I really learned. And what I find really very happy about is there are kids who have moved away from science after that, or sometimes they have gone into some other engineering colleges, they have sometimes gone into MBA after that, and so on. But they say, I still remember this, and they meet me after years and they come and tell me, I really like this way of introducing it. I have never forgotten that topic, right? That really makes my day. So,
brilliant. Yeah.
So that I think. Learning for lifelong learning, no? Learning is because it's good fun for us.
I
think is something, if we can get into kids, I think we're making a, I mean, that's the fun part.
That's the fun part of being a teacher. And that's exactly what we test for when we look at teacher competencies, especially in the content development and planning micro-credential. It's all about how you understand the linkages and sequences of various concepts, how you use different resources that are available to you in the classroom to teach students who are at various paths or various milestones in their learning journey. How do you instill a spirit of lifelong learning? How do you instill critical thinking skills, problem solving skills, etc.? So that brings me to my next question, that how do you, so when you have students who come from various backgrounds, so how do you assess where a student is? So what kind of assessment methods do you use to understand where a student is in his or her learning journey? And if you can share it or talk about it using some examples, that would be really great.
So I usually, for me, the question typically is, what is the purpose of our assessment?
Mm-hmm.
There are, sometimes as a person who takes IIT classes or like tuition classes and so on, often one reason for the assessment, to be honest, is because parents are asking. In fact, earlier I would never conduct tests, but parents would keep coming and saying, you're not conducting tests. So now we conduct lots of tests.
Okay.
Now, most of those tests are for parents.
Okay.
I also tell students, don't worry too much about it. So you can write the test, you get your marks and you show it to your parents. And that's one goal for whatever purpose it is.
Okay.
But the most important tests for me are tests for me.
Okay.
So I want to not look at whether this child knows something or not. That is one kind of assessment, to find out how much this child knows.
Mm-hmm.
But how many of these kids have understood what was taught? Do I need to do something differently?
Mm-hmm.
It is actually, that is the place where I feel the maximum learning happens, at least for me.
Okay.
Where I'm conducting a test more to understand, okay, I have taught you something.
Mm.
I think most of you would have understood, but have you?
Okay.
Are you able to apply? So there, usually, for example, I give 2-3 types of questions. One is, what I have taught, are you retaining it enough to be able to apply it directly?
Okay.
So that's a simple direct kind of a question, which is almost the same as what was done in class.
Mm-hmm.
The second kind of question is slightly different application.
Okay.
Which may be, which is not really off topic.
Mm-hmm.
It is within what was taught, but a slight variation of it. So how well have you understood it to be able to apply?
Okay.
So these are two things. If you did well, I feel that, okay, the class went well.
Okay.
Right. Then comes the third. So how well have you understood it enough to be able to connect it to something that we learned in the previous topic or in some other topic? So, but coming up with questions which actually does that connection is also good fun for us.
Okay.
But are children able to make that connection? So sometimes what happens is some children are not able to connect, partly because some are good at connecting things, some are not good at connecting.
Okay.
But if they are not able to do the first and second, you get feedback on, you need to redo certain things.
Okay.
Maybe you need to teach it differently.
Okay.
And depending on the percentage of children who have not understood something, we can also look at what went wrong, right?
Okay.
So then I usually use this as a, so there are certain assessments that I use to change what I'm doing.
Okay.
Then there are certain assessments that I use. They're not really assessments. They're actually class.
Okay.
So if I want to, because if you tell, talk too much in a class, like we are doing right now, mostly people don't listen. After some time, they switch off.
Okay.
So you
I
throw a quiz.
Our audience hasn't switched
off. Hopefully not. But so usually you throw it as a quiz.
Okay. Okay.
And if they get it wrong, then they will listen. Like if you tell them, hey, you know what? Displacement is a vector. It's an arrow. People are not going to remember. And they'll say, okay, this guy is like making too much fuss of it.
Okay.
So I say, okay, now I have this ball and I have this chalk piece.
Okay.
So this ball travels like that and then reaches this chalk piece. Okay.
Okay.
Right.
Okay.
And now let us say by the time this ball reached the chalk piece, this chalk piece traveled all over and reached the place where the ball was.
Okay.
So now is the distance traveled by the ball equal to the distance traveled by the chalk piece? And many kids will say no, because the chalk piece actually went in a different path.
Okay.
Then you say, is the displacement of the ball equal to displacement of the chalk piece? And they'll say yes.
Okay.
Then you say, no, that's wrong. And they say, oh, why is it wrong? It's correct.
Okay.
So what is the definition of displacement? Shortest distance, this fellow went this way, that fellow went that
way.
Then you say, wait, let me ask the next question.
Mm-hmm.
Is the magnitude of displacement of the ball equal to the magnitude of the displacement of the chalk piece? Then they say, oh yeah, this is correct, that is wrong.
Okay. Okay.
So what is the difference between displacement and magnitude of displacement?
Mm-hmm.
So displacement is an arrow.
Hmm.
Magnitude of the displacement is the length of the arrow.
Okay.
Now, therefore, the unfortunate definition that comes up in the book, displacement is the shortest distance. So I ask them, how can that be correct? Because distance is by definition a positive number.
Okay.
But displacement, you can have minus, negative, positive, you can, it's an arrow.
Okay. Okay.
So if I tell you the shortest girl in class is that boy, there is a sentence mistake that is there, right? The height of the shortest of that boy sounds okay.
Okay.
But the shortest girl in class is that boy won't make sense.
Hmm.
So shortest distance is displacement makes no sense. So then they kind of say, okay, but then the book says this, what do? You write that in the exam, but go ahead and learn it. Because then unless you make those mistakes, learning becomes hard. So I use assessment sometimes, not really as assessment, but as a learning tool.
Okay.
The second kind of assessment is this. The third kind of assessment is where you want to really find out this child has understood all this, but where exactly is the child?
Okay.
Where does the child have a gap? There you want to give Like, so, but that's very hard because the children come with a lot of knowledge, right?
Hmm.
So if you want to kind of pinpoint a particular thing, you need to do multiple layers of assessment. So you do one which is a broad-based thing.
Hmm.
Then you say, okay, this guy seems to have difficulty here, but you can't pinpoint it. So you give more questions of simpler and harder variety. So you find that, but sometimes when you give the assessment in an ordered way, they'll actually be able to solve.
Okay.
The problem often is that when it comes in an out of context kind of question, it is hard. So then you realize, okay, this guy is unable to do it in a different context, but is able to solve it in this. So then you can pinpoint exactly where the gap is. So, but that's a little harder. The diagnostic kind of tests is a little harder.
Okay. So I said, so what you're doing is you're using quizzes in the classroom to make assessments fun. You are again using sequencing and linkages amongst topics to identify where the misconceptions are. And you're also trying to use some out of context questions or assessment methodologies to really pinpoint where the doubt is. So
I also use a lot of videos. So I also tell them, okay, here I give you a lot of videos online. So we put it on our website.
Okay.
And then we say, you go learn and come.
Hmm.
I'm going to conduct a test on that.
Okay.
So if you have learnt it, I know how much of the learning you should have got through that.
Okay.
If you have not done it, either you've not done the homework or in case you still haven't understood, then we will discuss that in class and look at it. So usually when we create like a test of 10 questions, we try to do it as a mini test.
Mm-hmm.
We say, okay, the first 7-8 questions are, if you have learnt it, just test your direct learning.
Okay.
The last 2-3 questions are usually tricky questions where you have to seriously understand it deeply and apply it in a different type of a situation or context.
Okay.
So it's been kept challenging for all kids.
I think it's challenging and it's fun.
Yeah.
And it is instilling the concepts really deeply into the children's minds is what I'm taking away from it. And again, just to link this to Senda certification and the micro-credential that we have, which is student assessment and remediation, that's exactly the kind of teacher competencies that we test for, which is what kind of assessment tools that you're using in the classrooms, depending on how your learners are and what are the different contexts in which they are coming from. So for example, one of the common questions that we ask in the TPO is that the teacher has asked a question and the student has given a wrong answer. And then we give 4 options and ask the test taker to tell us, what do you think is the misconception that you can get from this assessment?
Actually, creating assessments where there are distractors.
Right, exactly.
Like this, right?
Yeah.
I think that's really good.
Yeah.
Also,
yeah.
That helps. The more we understand how children think,
yes.
The more common errors you find.
Yeah.
It's actually very useful to put that in because it becomes a nice learning tool. Because you say, this is what most kids will write.
Yeah, yeah.
That's because you have this misconception. So based on your answer, you can actually pinpoint what they're thinking. And that's the fun part of teaching experience itself, right?
So everybody learns in the process. Yeah. So I'm going to just take some questions now and see if people have any questions. Sorry, it's not very visible to me. So I'm going to move the camera a little bit. One second.
So we're getting some comments also. Arpita Agarkar, one of our teachers, says, take one topic each year to
learn and
because you can't do much more than that, and it sometimes takes 2 years to do one topic just to understand it ourselves.
Exactly. I'm just trying to scroll. There are a lot of comments that we are getting. Just give me a second to read where are the questions. Do you have anything for modern physics? One of the teachers,
actually, one of the things that we do is that we have a website where we are putting up a lot of our lot of free videos and so on. Maybe I can put up that as a maybe link on the ahaguru.com and we can see that also. So modern physics in all of these topics, like semiconductors, for example, we did a whole session because lots of teachers also found that hard.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So we did a complete set of lectures on semiconductors. So that kind of thing may be useful.
Okay.
Partly, see, nowadays, the big problem, at least with physics, you find is that many different new topics and new things keep coming up all the time. Like many of the teachers, when they studied, semiconductors were probably not even there.
Hmm.
Okay.
So now it's there as communication systems is part of the syllabus. So you have to learn, update, and then teach it. And there's so many different new things to learn continuously. So as teachers, you have to keep being up to date. No? So
that I becomes... think a lot of people are agreeing with you about the whole structure of the textbooks, the syllabus, and the constraints.
I think at least physics teachers will agree.
The classrooms.
I think it's true with the math and chemistry and other subjects also.
And... if there are any questions, please do let us know. I'm not able to scroll very well right now. Sorry, I'm not able to see the questions. If there are any questions, please do post and we'll
I think maybe take them. Then.
Okay. So I think a lot of people are agreeing with you in terms of the resources and the methodologies that you spoke about, the constraints that the teachers face, and making the entire learning process fun and enjoyable and lifelong for the children. So with that, we'll bring the session to the close. Thank you.
Welcome. Thank you.
Question from
Arpita
Agatha.
I just ended it.